So the first time I met Gary Dunham, I was working in a hotel in Dunbar called Verosborough. One night, Gary Dunham walked in, ordered 8 Jaeger bombs, proceeded to tell me he was a Russian millionaire. He loved the band Clutch. He'd seen my band Sylvanus play, and he thought we were fucking rad. And we've been friends ever since.
Gary Dunham has always been one of the greatest pissheads I've ever known. He's a true wonder on the drink. He's an inspiration to me and everyone else in the band.
So Gary and his group of friends used to come into the Rossboro from around 2009. He's probably just turned 18. And started off, he's just coming drinking, and eventually we were just coming in to hang out with me. We were all into the same sort of music. And in that crew, they were all sort of skateboarders, musicians. So it was Fraser Lowe, Mark Sean Valder, Steve Engel, and Gary Dunham, the man himself.
Big Sean held the bar well, and you know, used to do the boys the deals, used to slide the boys the drinks, you know, upheld the law, made sure there was no shenanigans going on, if you will.
Needed somewhere to hang out, and it turned, just so happens, fate brought them to my bar, and we're all into the same sort of music, and they're all into skating. And got on really well, and eventually ended up working with a huge amount of them, building skate parks. In the summer of 2010 is when Robot Death Monkey really got going. We got the opportunity to build an indoor skate park in this old potato shed. It was haggard as fuck, but it was, you know, our alone little project. And we built it for the summer, and I think kids had to pay a membership of like £1 to come and use it. We built a stage, and when we were building all the ramps, and me, Sam and Steve were listening to a lot of Earthless and Karma to Burn, and we're just like, fuck it, let's get a band together. I hadn't played bass before. Obviously Sam had been playing a bit in our previous band Sylvanus, and Steve used to play in a band called the Caponas. They were like a Guns N' Roses ripoff, fairly shit, but he wasn't really enjoying that, so we got him to join, and we formed Robot Death Monkey. Talking about Robot Death Monkey, our main influences, it's kind of hard to ignore me and Sam's previous band, Sylvanus. Me and Sam, who's my little brother, used to play in this band called Sylvanus with Thomas Newell and Alan Travers.
I think the first kind of influence has got to be the Sylvanus influence. I think the style of playing, that kind of riff style, and it came from Sylvanus and what we created there. And I think Sean always used to watch what I was doing on bass, and you know, and that kind of style of playing, which was, you know, pick heavy, and you know, and just those riffs and bits and pieces like that. So I think that first influence, that, you know, without one, you don't get the other, and I think it's very much of that.
It's kind of hard to describe the music of Sylvanus. I mean, it was riff heavy, it was thrashy. I think Tom coming in definitely brought that prog rock edge to it. You know, first time I met Tom, you know, all we did was talk about Tool. We loved that band. I brought more of a grungy edge, classic rock, Rage Against the Machine was a big influence in those early days. Sean and Sam, of course, brought the heavier edge, you know. Pantera, Down, they introduced me to bands like Caius, you know, stoner rock. And we started off by playing covers, you know, we did Stone the Crow and like Thumb, which we ended up playing at our first gig, you know, Linton Live.
So So Sylvanas was formed in 2006 and lasted till about 2009. I think we played gigs up to 2013 as that band, but it was a very much one practice and try and play a gig as, you know, rough and ready as possible, I think. And that was a kind of, I guess, started off as a sort of just a heavy metal band and progressed into sort of like a prog sort of stoner vibe. But in 2009, Tom and Alan both moved to the northeast of England, and things kind of became unattainable with a 200 mile commute, and those two were writing 15-20 minute songs, and it was just undoable.
I just think with the journey of those guys coming through, they weren't quite as into the music. It came a bit of a hassle, and Sylvanas never really stopped, it just kind of fizzled out.
So in 2010, me and Sam came back from Roadburn Festival, where I had all the THC in the world, drank about a million Donalds, and then got trapped in Holland because of a volcano erupting in Iceland. And me and Sam had a lot of time, and we decided, after seeing all these cool bands, we saw Earthless, Karma to Burn, John Garcia Sings Caius, Los Nates, we saw all these stoner bands that are a big influence in our playing now, decided to start a project because we were so like hyped off going to this big festival and seeing all these bands that we loved, and just thought, fuck it, let's form our own band. And that's where Stephen Ingle came in, and we were building skate parks with him out in East Linton, and we were buddies. He was hanging out at the pub almost every night, and it just seemed the perfect fit. So Robot Death Monkey was born in 2010.
Not really sure how long I played with RDM, or if I ever started playing for RDM, or if I ever stopped playing with RDM. Don't really know, but I think we can all agree that I single-handedly put this band on the map for being the hardest guy to ever play or be associated with the band. I love a lot of stoner rock, I love a lot of fucking Orange Goblin, Caius, the likes, you know, the usuals, if you will.
So we probably played with Steve Ingle for about 6 months. Turns out Stephen Ingle's one of the flakiest motherfuckers you're ever going to meet.
Sean and Sam bring the gauntlet down. If you're not pulling your weight and if you're not a top performer, the gauntlet's coming for you. So, you know, it seems like I probably wasn't pulling the weight. I know I'm a notorious ghoster, so it's probably something to do with that. I was probably fucking about with something else at the time, or had some other stupid idea. I'm one of these guys that likes to go off on tangents in life. But yeah, pretty gutted.
It's pretty clear that Stephen Ingle's always been a patching bastard, and that's why we had to kick him out of the band.
Robot Death Monkey went down to a two-piece for a while, and then in late 2010 we moved skate parks. We had this skate park built in a barn in East Linton, and we moved to this old golf factory in North Berwick, which would be the home of Robot Death Monkey for the next 5 years, and that was the Space skate park.
The Space was a good time for RDM because it really gave the lads the opportunity to start growing their success, to start really forming their own personality as a brand and their own individuality, and you know, really going all in on something and having the opportunity to do it, and having a great bunch of lads around them to shoot ideas from and between. I think Sean and Sam at this point really grew as people too, and you know, dare I say that Sean is the captain of the ship when it comes to RDM, and Sam is the foundation of the ship, that without there would be no buoyancy.
All the Dunbar crew were helping build this indoor skate park with me and Sam, and it was a cool time. And one of the guys that was helping build this skate park was Max Schoenwalder, who became the second Robot Death Monkey guitarist. We didn't really want to step on Steve's toes, so we ended up changing the name. So I don't think we'd ever told Steve he was out of the band. It was just he just stopped showing up, and we stopped asking. So with Max, we decided to change the band name to Robot Death Monkey and the Time Traveling Hornet. It lasted probably about a year, maybe the winter of 2010 to probably about the same time, winter 2011. And in that time, we really honed our skills with Max. I went from not being able to play anything on the bass to being fairly proficient. I started off finding it really difficult to sing and play the bass. From going from just singing in the other band to singing and playing took me a while to learn. So I think the first songs we'd written with Steve, we'd written a lot of pauses in the songs to put vocals in, and with Max, I'd managed to practice enough so I didn't have to do that. The highlight of playing with Max, playing the Liver Pounder, Gary Dunham's 21st birthday. The Liver Pounder was out in these woods at the beach in East Lothian, and it was like something out of Evil Dead. It was in this old cabin, and it was just a rad night of people getting fucked up and having a good time. Probably winter 2011, things were starting to take its toll on me, Sam and Max. We're all working together and spending a lot of time together, and just wasn't working out.
I always enjoy playing with the Time Traveling Hornet, however, you could barely drink two fruity ciders without a fucking bean off his tits.
We asked Max to leave the band. I don't think it was very polite either. I think it was Max, you're out of the band. No talking about it or anything, and me and Sam done it. I think we had a gig that night, and we went on to play as Robot Death Monkey for the next year as a two-piece. The Hornet was dead, Robot Death Monkey lived on.
Robot Death Monkey, out of nowhere. And I think they used to be called Time Traveling Hornet or something like that. But yeah, just Robot Death Monkey. Just a two-man, you know, riff machine.
You know, first time seeing them, John had plugged his bass into like the guitar amp and the bass amp and come up with this kind of sludgy, fuzzy tone that, you know, melt your face off. It was ace. First time seeing him play bass. And it was simple, but it was effective. It was kind of had elements of Sylvanas, but you know, all the complexities taken out. It was just like riff after riff. Most of it was instrumentals at the time, but he was singing a little bit. But songs just in 2 or 3 minutes. It was focused. It was, you know, little bangers.
Two brother riff machine, drums and bass, and Sean on top with the vocals. I was like, fantastic. And I think when I saw that video, that Gary Dunham video, I was like, yeah, this is great. This is really cool. And it was just kind of Sylvanas really distilled and, you know, filtered down to its essence, which was Sean and Sam, because they were the ones that kind of got the band going originally. And yeah, it was brilliant. Sounded good. You know, it was big riffs and a lot of fun. And that's what them guys are all about.
So, highlight playing as a two-piece was releasing the music video Gary Dunham. We'd written a song with Max, but me and Sam recorded all the pieces as a two-piece. I ended up playing guitar on it. And one of the highlights from the music video is my friend Ryan Henderson, who shot all our music videos. There's a shot of it where it goes to a three-piece in the quarry. And a lot of it was filmed. All of it was filmed as me and Sam playing. I had the mask on for most of it, and it was shot with me playing bass and Sam in the background, and then me on guitar with the mask on with Sam in the background. But we really wanted to have a shot to make it look like there was three of us playing in the band. So that the third person was Ryan Henderson wearing the mask and my hoodie, playing the guitar from afar. I think that was quite cool because I've always seen Ryan Henderson, as well as Gary Dunham, as a member of Robot Death Monkey.
So the idea for that video was, Gary was a known skater of the area. He was also a kind of legend, a living legend, you would say. But I'll talk more about Gary later. But like I say, the mantra of these videos was not to either plan, put any real kind of work into it, and literally just go out somewhere and see what happens. Because supposedly, Sean was adamant that that would work. Now, as someone who's gone through the system, made several films and stuff over his time, it kind of goes against my principles to not plan a single fucking thing and just kind of see what happens. But I guess that's the beauty of Robot Death Monkey, in a sense, is that this happened probably no less than 6 times after this, and they all turned out pretty good. Or at least good in the sense that they weren't a mitigated fucking disaster. But I have quite an affinity towards the Gary Dunham video. This is at a time where I'm like working with a bunch of other people as well. So just kind of using this as a way to kind of hang out with your friends and do things together, it was perfect. Unfortunately though, I can actually put this moment where I head out to East Linton and we film this video as the trigger point for my girlfriend at the time to want to break up with me. I don't know if there's a relation, but I could blame the band. She swanned off to America to go fuck a guy on a boat with a bulldog. So we go to the skate park, we go to see Gary, or Gary's gonna come see us, and for whatever reason, he'd just come back from like a sponsored skate up the fucking Himalayas or something. He seemed that he did a lot of these things. Very admirable. But basically he couldn't really walk, let alone have him doing anything in the skate park. So really all we did, and it only took one shot, one take, was I just filmed Gary smoking a cigarette. And you know what? I think it's genius.
So me and Sam played as a two-piece for a good year. Played loads of gigs. I split my bass signal into two pedals, had an octaver. We were doing that whole Royal Blood thing before Royal Blood thing was a thing. Pretty good. And that's kind of the way me and Sam have always wanted to write songs, as if it could play as a two-piece, because guitarists cannot be trusted one bit. So as long as the two of us know how to do it, we're going to be fucking flying. But after playing for a year, we decided it's probably time to get a guitarist in. And Travs was in the process of moving back up to Edinburgh. He'd finished uni, and I think he was moving up to, his girlfriend was moving up to Edinburgh, and so was he. And we decided to ask Alan to come back with the band.
Well, we always kept in touch when I was in Newcastle. You know, it wasn't like you've got another band now, we're not going to talk to you. You know, as I said, I used to come through and see them. And, you know, I've known the boys since I was like 5 years old. And they've had a couple of guitarists that went through Max and Steve. Or was it the other way around? I don't know. Didn't work out for certain reasons. And the boys have started working at the Space in North Berwick. And kind of evolved from Fantasy, you know. Tragically, it's been taken down for some old folks' homes, but, you know, at the time, it was a good place for the youth to go. You had a big skate park there, you had loads of different shops, a cafe, a record shop. Most importantly, you had this big practice room that we could play in whenever, you know, for free, because the boys worked there. And I was through North Berwick one weekend, and, you know, they were saying, you know, come and have a jam with us. They were back to a two-piece, and, you know, I'd learnt their old songs. And we had this like 3-hour jam, and they had a couple of riffs. I think the beginnings of Dragon Clip was there. I'd come up with a couple, which I think led to like Shadow of the Mountain. You know, after 2-3 hours, we had a couple of songs on the go. And it was like, pretty much decided then, you know, Alan, you're back in the band, the lead guitarist, you know. Three lads are back together.
Come back into the fold, where we belonged, with the boys, me and Alan. Share a lot of history. I went to nursery, primary school and high school with Alan. Played in Sylvanus for 7 years with him. So pretty honoured for him to be in Robot Death Monkey from 2013 right up to today. So probably a good 15 years of making music with Alan. So that's pretty impressive. No brainer. And then shortly after, maybe 6 months, we were playing a gig down in Newcastle that Tom had been putting on.
Tom was putting on the night. He asked us to come and play. I mean, it was a bit weird because I was thinking, he's not in the band anymore, but he wants us to come and play his night. He'd put on these nights before that we'd done. And it was at a tiny little bar in Newcastle, Bar Loco. It was like an art show. So, you know, I'd already done some improv music with Tom at the beginning of the night. It was like poetry being written. Tom was in like a little art show in the middle of it. And, you know, on the bill, RDM just didn't fit in. And, you know, I said to the guys, we'll just go on, we'll do our thing, we'll have a good night. Because, you know, we're all feeling a bit uncomfortable about it. Anyway, we'll go on. And honestly, the place is fucking jumping. I'd never seen the venue like that. And, you know, just, it was probably a good thing that everyone was nicely fueled up by the time we went on. But, you know, it was just so good for me, personally, just to play with those guys again, be back in the band. And what's better, Tom comes on and joins us for the last song.
That was cool fun. It was great to play. It was great to hang out, which is what it's always been about, being in a band. You know, there's being creative and there's, you know, writing music together, but it's hanging out, spending time together. That's what being in a band is partly about. Yeah, Robot Death Monkey played like most of their set. Then I kind of came on and played with them for that last one sort of thing. I mean, they are killing it. Everybody was sort of like moshing and dancing and rocking out. Amazing, you know, the whole place went crazy. And that came at the end and we played together and it was really nice. It was kind of like a homecoming. It'd been a couple of years since we played together and it kind of meant a lot. We had a load of fun and it was a brilliant night. And then after that, Sean was like, come on, let's just come back into Robot Death Monkey and, you know, play with the band. And I was like, okay, yeah.
For me, it was just like Tom and Alan were just rejoining the band. They never really left.
And it was back to the same band we were in before. The same pickle we were in before with 200-mile commutes. And it was made a lot easier this time around with things like WhatsApp and the internet being a lot better. You could record riffs and send it down, and we'd made big points of not playing a song live until it was recorded, so that Tom could at least practice to the recorded version. Whereas in Sylvanas, we didn't have any recordings. It was all, I think there's maybe 4 videos on YouTube that says we were a band for 7 years. Those changes were able to happen. We got Tom in and played Audio Suit Festival straight away.
I was made up, you know? So it was like coupling my two favorite things. A, playing in a band with my pals, and B, being at a festival. So, you know, but the hardest thing was trying to keep sober, because I think we were playing like 1 or 2 o'clock on the Saturday afternoon. So me and Alan, you know, Sean and Sam were coming on the Saturday. Me and Alan were camping the night before with Stig. And Sean and Sam were like, don't you dare go too hard. And we were like, no, we won't go too hard. And it was like, right, Alan, 11 o'clock, go to bed. 12 o'clock, we'll go to bed. Yeah. 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock, we'll go to bed, we'll call it.
3 o'clock, I better go to bed after this one. I mean, I think it was about 5 or 6 in the morning when we rock up back to the tent. A few hours kip. I remember waking up to like Tom passing me a beer and he's just like, I've got to get up. I'm looking at the time, I was like, you still got a couple hours to the gig. You know, at that point, all you've got to do is just keep going. We have plenty of beer available to do that. So we rock up about 10 minutes to go. We meet Sean and Sam up just outside the tent. The safety shades are on. We play the gig.
Tom played for the band from 2013 to 2018, a good 5-year stint in which we'd released Fool Dunham, the Dragon Clip music video, we'd released Booze Cruise EP and Booze Cruise music video, which is absolutely killer.
You know, we're very lucky to know someone like Ryan. You know, he's been with us since the beginning. I see him as pretty much part of the band, almost as much as Dunham. You know, he's done all our music videos. Even in Sylvanus, we did our first one in the barn. He did, the first one I did with him was Dragon Clip. And then there was Booze Cruise. We all remember that. You know, John had this amazing, simple idea of saying, well, just get on a boat and we're gonna sail around North Berwick, we'll get Gary Dunham and we'll just drink a bottle of JD. And what more can you want? But yeah, I'm in. And I remember driving down there on the day, and of course, there's not a boat. Where the hell are we getting a boat from? But there is a big yellow inflatable rubber dinghy.
But when that boat got involved and we were messing around with Gary Dunham, and it was a beautiful evening and the sun shining in, it was so much fun. I mean, I'm laughing just thinking about it now. And you can see that joy, you can see that camaraderie and like the vibe of who we are as people coming through in the video. So I think it was well captured, well edited, and it's a great track, you know. Booze Cruise, what's that to like? That is a brilliant pop song.
I can quite easily say that that day was a hell of a lot of fun. Because if anything, the general concept for every video we ever made together was that let's just hang out with the lads and have a laugh. And I think Booze Cruise perfectly shows that from start to finish. And it's just shot really well. I think I did a good job with this one.
So for me, it's club nights we play. There's a night called Hellraiser at Banshee Labyrinth in Edinburgh with Bud and Luke, who put on that night, and they're always fucking cool guys. I think we're almost a house band. I don't think there's many people that played more than Robot Death Monkey at Hellraiser night. And the same goes for, there used to be a night at Studio 24 in Edinburgh called The Bunker. It was run by Seth and Sean. And what they took out the dance floor, put skate ramps on it, and there'd be the stage and then skate ramps, and it was just fucking a cool night. Me and Sam obviously working at our skate park out in North Berwick, just nice to hang out with the same guys that were coming down and get hammered with them. And Steve England, the Druids' first ever gig was at the Bunker, and it was live on STV.
To play us out, sorry, we've got Steve England and the Druids. Take it away, guys.
Hardest band in East Lothian!
Success in life is measured in how hard you are and how hard other people think you are.
Not too shabby for a band that's a joke. So Stephen the Druids started as a Robot Death Monkey tribute band because Tramps couldn't make a gig, and we decided to play with Steve, and we were just playing old songs that we used to play with Steve with some covers, and that kind of... That's kind of where that was born.
I never saw Steve England and the Druids as a side project. It was just pretty much just a branch of Robot the Death Monkey.
Yeah, another one of my favourite gigs was when the boys headlined Audio Soup, wrecked it, played the best set ever, got the place jumping, and then, like, a week later, the organiser, I can't remember, whoever was organising that tent, slid into the DMs of Steve England and the Druids and asked if we'd do their Halloween night. And the boys demanded £100 each and headliner, and she said no. So the boys told her to beat it, and she told us we'd never get back on Audio Soup. Jude, or whatever her name was, can't remember, basically told us to fuck off, and she said that we'd never get back on the bill for an Audio Soup again. But little did she know that the Druids were the number one hardest band in East Lothian, and it only took us another year or 2 years to get back on that bill, where obviously we demanded the headliner. Top tip for all you bands out there, the way you do it is you just call it. So we weren't on the bill for Audio Soup, but what we did was we took the actual Audio Soup poster and we just put our name in there and we released it. So it looked like we were on the bill. They can't take you off the bill if you're on the bill. So that's how you do it. Photoshop is your greatest friend.
in 2018, Tom left the band.
It just became kind of difficult for Tom. He was in a couple of bands down in Newcastle, and I think it was just too much for him. And it's been the first member of Robot Death Monkey to leave on his own accord, to be honest. A sad day. Sad day in Robot Death Monkey history when Tom left the band.
You know, we missed Tom when he left. You know, he contributed a lot to the songwriting. And, you know, RDM can work as a three-piece. You know, it can work as a two-piece, we know that. But, you know, Fraz, a.k.a. Taco, a.k.a. fucking Thunderfingers, has come in and brought something extra. You know, I don't think I've met anyone who can shred like Taco.
I've always been a massive admirer of Taco's playing. He's an absolute shredder beyond belief.
I mean, just listen to Eggy Bread.
He played that solo one take. He didn't even practice beforehand. He was just lubed. Man's greasy. Anyway, yeah. Always good to have Fraz in the band because he's a menace. The man can drink 18 pints. Robot Death Monkey is formed on your ability to drink pints, and it's your ranking is very much in the band is where you sit. Fraz is on 18, I'm on 14 at the moment, Sam's on 12, Trav's made it to 11 once, and I think he almost died. So yeah, Fraz is probably the hardest member of the band at the moment, but I'm gunning for him. I'd like to point out those 14 beers I drank as well were Super Strength Polish beer as well. Fraz was probably just drinking Coors Light.
Basically what happened is, we were at a party, Halloween party, all dressed up. Big Fraz, the big man, came into our room where I was at. And I think he had like a Satan wand thing prop. And I took it off him. And you know, I was doing like I normally do, winding him up, hitting him on the chin with it, hitting him on the head. And he couldn't get it back off me. And you know, I gave him a few more taps. And the big man just went, grabbed his bottle, unopened the bottle, big bottle of Heine. Smashed it off my head, hit my head so hard that it bounced and hit the roof of the room that we were in, and then obviously split my head open, and then passed out a couple of times, blood everywhere, horrible time. And then I remember the ambulance coming, and the lads had left me outside this house with a bag of crisps to wait for the ambulance on my own, totally away with it. The ambulance came, stuck a wound back together and all that nonsense, and you know, crazy times, but never mess with the big man.
And just like that, Fraz had barred Steve, Robot Death Monkey became Scotland's hardest band.
I'd say there's still plenty of life left in RDM, you know? It's been like 15 years now of us making music together, if you include Sylvanus, and you know, it's frustrating at times, I'm not gonna lie. Being in a band can be. Especially when Tom left, I thought, I've got to take on the four shows by myself now. But, you know, I've known those guys my whole life. And when we look back on some of the things we've done, you know, releasing EPs, playing great gigs, the music videos, you know, it's worth it. And, you know, they're making more music than ever right now during this lockdown. It's been a positive thing. He sent me another song the other day. And I think the next stage is to get songs on Spotify. Hopefully gig again once this is all over. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's just four lads having a good time, doing what they love to do.
I want to record more music, and I want to gig more, and I want to drink pints. You go to band practice, you get to drink pints. You go to a gig, you get to drink pints. You go hang out, you drink pints. It's essentially being having friends, but with a good hobby. And that's essentially all I like, want in life, is to have a good time and drink pints. So that's why I hold for Robot Death Monkey. So more tunes, Fortunately, Ryan's moved to America now, so music videos might be off the cards for a little while, but my good friend Stephen Ingle is in on the music video game, I hear. So we might try and get something going with him. And yeah, just play big fucking riffs and having a good time.